We'd examine the tables to see if they were dusty. If everything was neat and tidy, that would be fine. If not, I would tell the women to do it better. We cleaned the alley and put up posters. One said, everyone must help to exterminate the four pests.
Nothing escaped attention. One of the official pests was the sparrow. The small birds were accused of devouring the crops.
The word came down from above to mobilize the people to kill the sparrows. Villagers of all ages joined in. We were so busy, we even had to take turns to eat. The trees were really high and hard to shake, but everyone did their best so the sparrows couldn't land. We used slingshots. Some people used guns. Whoever killed the most sparrows was praised and given rewards. Those who caught fewer were criticized and encouraged to do better the next day.
In fact, the campaign backfired. With the sparrows gone, more insects survived to strip the crops. The same effort to get mass participation was applied to another type of cleansing, of incorrect thoughts. People were asked to look out for neighbors or fellow workers who seemed to meet the party's description of rightists or capitalists or counter-revolutionaries. They were then denounced. But the boldest attempt to harness the energy and enthusiasm of the people came in 1958. To speed up progress, Mao wanted to use the force he believed in most, China's sheer numbers, for his great leap forward. Propaganda cartoons showed how the Chinese were meant to overtake Western industry and food production. Land so ceremoniously given to the peasants after the revolution was now taken back, and the peasants were herded into huge communes. District Secretary Zhen Guodong oversaw the operation in his area.
I was responsible for setting up people's communes and turned 8 agricultural cooperatives into 2 big communes. There were over 100,000 people in each one. Big communes could handle big projects. With thousands of people to do a job, things were completed in no time.
Production brigades were sent where they were thought to be needed most, under military-style discipline. The party said it was a more efficient, better, faster way to build socialism. Private ownership of land had already been eliminated. Now family life was to be destroyed as well. Peasants were to eat food cooked in central kitchens. Children would be looked after together. Mao set the target of doubling food production in 1 year. Revolutionary enthusiasm, he said, will triumph over all obstacles. He took a close interest as the peasants tried to increase yields. When the Dongsheng Commune promised a record harvest, it was Zhen Guodong, the district secretary, who showed the chairman around.
Chairman Mao himself visited the show field and asked how much it was expected to yield. My colleague said 50,000 pounds an acre. Chairman Mao replied, Even if you could achieve 10% of that, it would be a miracle.
Wheat yields had typically been about 500 pounds an acre. Now the party encouraged competition among the communes to push up the yields.
各乡各社的英雄们用喝干大海斩赚高山的气概摆开了争夺水稻冠军的擂台三关乡的好汉们首先扯起了水稻亩产3000斤紧跟着下岗乡的好汉涌上擂台大声喝道保证水稻亩产4000斤秋后丰收上北京北国乡的英雄们哪能落后三关措施加了马，我们措施带火箭，我们亩产5000斤。全县各乡打擂台的英雄和干部们一起宣誓，争取水稻超过1000斤。
The pledges were absurd, but the communes falsified their records to back them up.
就把那个生产的好稻子拔到那儿，堆到那儿去的。
We removed the already planted rice from the fields and replanted it in a show field so that we could reach our quota.
是搞不好的。
Planting it so densely with no light or wind blowing through meant it would rot.
搞了时间不长就都烂了。
Before long, the rice did rot, and the peasants got angry. They said, if you take all the rice and waste it, what will we eat in the autumn?
好稻子拔走，我这一亩地能产一斤。
The peasants didn't want to go on with this cheating.
拔了以后，我们秋后没饭吃。
I tried to get it stopped, but the local boss ordered us to carry on.
市里头领导知道了，找了我，说你还得搞。
But the false statistics contributed to a dangerous delusion that China had plenty of food and could concentrate on other things.We must reach for the moon and the stars, said Mao. Man can achieve anything he can imagine. Huge construction projects also pitted great masses of people against apparently insuperable obstacles. Lin County in Hunan was an arid plain blocked off by mountains. The 1,800-mile-long Red Flag Canal was planned to bring in water over the rocky terrain.The canal workers were celebrated as revolutionary heroes. Zhen Yongcheng worked on the rock face.
I tie a rope around my body and swing out into the air. I used a pick to remove the loose stones. When they fell, I had to try hard to keep out of the way to avoid getting my legs broken.
Accidents were frequent. Zhen Yongcheng was sent to clear up afterwards.
When you were at the foot of the mountain and looked up, you could see bits of flesh glinting in the sun. I climbed down the rope. I picked up some dirt to wipe away every trace of the bodies. Otherwise, people would have been too frightened to carry on.
But the canal took twice as many people and far longer to build than expected.
Initially, there were 30,000 on the project. The plan was that if each person built 1 meter, the canal would be completed in 1 or 2 months. But it was all much more difficult because the canal was halfway up a mountain. In the end, it took 10 years to complete.